Good morning. Good morning. We are on a road trip with my son, Kate. Big Fox here. We've been up in the Idaho area doing some office furniture install. And we are headed over. We are headed over to one of our favorite Idaho growers, Cliff Warren. So I gave Cliff about 20 minutes notice before I showed up to his house. He left work, came home for lunch, so thanks, Cliff, for doing that. Sorry for popping in on you, but that's kind of how it goes. So we've been driving out here in the Idaho country, and I have to say it is pretty darn beautiful. A lot of green. This year it's super green out. All the crops look awesome. And we actually took an extra road, so we got to see a little bit extra country than we needed to, but it was worth it. Thanks for taking me on short notice. And this place is very nice. I'm loving it.
Not very many secrets here.
Good morning.
Elise here. And some's out in the yard.
Do I have your shoes on here?
No. Maybe it's all good.
Only one secret, right? It's this hedge right here.
Okay. The hedge?
We come into our other world here.
Oh, nice.
So we've got, you know, a general garden here. Some of it's been weeded, some
onions, potatoes,
work,
corn.
Corn here, and
nice see grapes out on the back fence.
Yeah, that's a vine, but there's no grapes.
Oh, okay.
They should be grapes.
But the horse. Oh, is that a Virginia creeper? Is that what that
Virginia
is?
Creeper.
Okay.
And over on this fence is Virginia creeper.
Okay.
So what?
Almost everything on the fence.
So here we are. Now you notice this is pretty basic shade structure here.
Yeah, I've seen you do it this way for years.
You know, the idea is if it was a hot sunny day, you know, the plant. Each part of the plant at this stage would be shaded at least for a little while.
Right.
You know, you don't have to have it shaded every minute of the
day. Yeah, I've done that where I just kind of leapfrog the main along, you know.
Mm-hmm. And this one, the idea also is if it started to hail, at least we would be protecting the newest parts of the plant, which are the parts that can get damaged pretty badly.
So I see fruit out there on the head.
So yeah, this is the 849. And, you know, a week ago it had a hoop house on it, and that's, you know, not protecting anything now. I can just pick it up and move it. This yellow flag is the 10-foot mark.
Oh, okay.
So we're about 7.5 maybe there.
Yeah, maybe so it looks eight. Like you'll at that flag you might hit fruit again, huh?
Hope so.
What you're thinking?
Hope so, and this is way ahead of the game for me. You know, normally I'm pollinating in the second or third week of July, and I started this way early this year, and it's paid off. I had a different type of hoop house, a little tiny thing. It was something pre-formed. I bought it on Amazon, and those work so well.
Mm-hmm.
Oh man! Except for they outgrow them too fast.
Right, right. I know you get them in a hoop, and they're nice and happy and. They take off.
Yeah. But I'm kind of a low budget grower. As you can tell, I kind of just take things easy. So we'll go over here. This was the 849. Really beautiful plant so far. It's just really starting to take shape.
And you're getting plenty of flowers on it.
Oh yeah, every morning. We've already got flowers. A little bit of weeding that ought to happen here. And this is the 500. This is that seed that grew the 849. It's also starting to take shape. It's probably a little closer to its 10-foot mark. Well, I don't know.
Yeah, you're right.
It's also about between 7 and 8 feet right now, which on the 5th of June, like I say, I'm usually just barely starting to grow a vine at that point. You know,
so have you always grown like this type of patterns? Is this is going to be your like a Christmas tree? And
yeah, I mean, at this stage they're kind of unruly. They want to grow, the vines want to grow, you know, parallel with the main, and I have to get rope and try to shape them. And right now this plant really needs some shaping and some burying and so forth.
Yeah, here when it gets, well, the heat's turning on and then it's going to be full bore,
yeah.
Time to bury.
Yeah, it's, we were starting to get good weather, and now today we're back into this wet pattern again, looks like.
Yeah.
So this is patch west. Over there is patch east. Got them going and a good start, you know, and.
I noticed down there you got a trellis. You have any gourds going on the trellis?
Well, I had gourds. I had 7 plants there. We had a 25 degree night, and even though they recovered, I lost about half of them. So I have the giant pear gourd from
Leo,
and Leonardo Urena, and I have some other things. But the long gourds got zapped, frozen.
Yeah.
And I tried to replant. It was the weirdest thing. Because all my gourds came up in like 3 days, and they never come up 3 days, and gourds don't do that. So I planted them. Then the next batch I planted, nothing germinated. It was just the weirdest thing in the world. I said, okay, I've got to plant up, you know, a bunch of backups. I have plenty of time. Still April. Could not get anything to germinate after that. That's our life.
Yeah, I've had that struggle with the gourds too. And then Chad was telling me this year he had put them in and forgot about them. They were in soaking in water, so for 24 hours, and then he's like, yeah, that's what worked. So he soaked them for 24 hours, so
yeah,
actually that's what I tried and seemed to work.
Probably the haste in trying to get the second batch going.
Yeah,
you know, and those seeds, they know your feelings, and so yeah, you know, but yeah, they just take your time, relax. Tomorrow's a new day.
Yeah.
So, yeah. But I did notice after the freeze that the giant pear made it. Both of my long gourds didn't. I've got some other things, you know, like the green apple gourd, bushel gourd. So they have to go 10 feet just to get to the top.
That's pretty good.
Last year I made the mistake. I had this set up underneath really large willow over there where it would get a lot of shade in the afternoon.
Yeah.
And then we had an August that was just like this all of August last year. Gray and raining all the time. And so they never really got going.
Well, I like your trellis too.
So it's
very simple.
Yeah, it's real simple. It's 10 feet up on the top. So if we ever get a long gourd going, we know about how long it is by how it's hanging there.
So you've seen Rise of the Giants and Leo's gourd tunnel, haven't
you?
Yeah. Man, oh man.
Yeah.
That's what I want. I'm going to be working on that in years to come here.
In fact, I might reshape these one of these years and buy a few more of them and make a real gourd tunnel.
Pumpkins. I'm going to get pumpkins up on
them. Pumpkins on them too, yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'd just love to be able to do that here.
Is that a Ford down there?
That is a Ford 8N tractor.
You make me a little nervous with the pitchfork. I don't know if I'm going to... You're going to run me out of here if I get out of hand.
I have a habit of having the pitchfork in my hand. These are some... giant field.
Oh, cool.
They're not very far along yet. Little baby cool. Thing.
So you have, I see a number of them here.
Yeah,
3,
some
4.
Other regular fields, and then behind it was the largest giant field at this stage, but it's still approaching where it needs to be to start to vine out.
Yeah.
Just didn't have a hoop house or anything. Pretty low budget. I've got a lot of weeding to do. One thing that I want to do with the pitchfork, you know, after we've had all this rain, the soil just gets so compacted. And, you know, I try to come out here and loosen things up. Try not to rip up the roots at the same time.
What kind of things are you doing for bugs at this point? Just watching for them? Do you?
I don't get bugs.
Don't get bugs? I'm sorry, I even said the word.
No, I mean, I don't, I do get some bugs. You know, some of this is hail damage. And I think some of it is bugs, but you notice I've got boom right here, right through the leaf, and I get that all the time. And we did have a hailstorm, a couple. But I think there are some bugs that I don't really see. Sometimes we get cucumber beetles, but you know, once every 3 or 4 years, maybe.
Huh.
That's it.
You guys are lucky, man.
I trade your weather for your bugs.
Looks like there's a lot of room up here. I could move right in and grow right alongside you. Yeah.
So this one is an 1873 steel, and this one's kind of a disappointment. It's not growing very fast.
Did it have a hoop?
It did.
Yeah.
In fact, on a day like today, I should take these portable hoop houses and just throw them back on.
Yeah.
This morning I slept in a little too much and really didn't get a lot going.
So the portable hoop.
Yeah, I mean.
You just pick it up, drag it.
Pick it up, put it down wherever you need it. And if you want to weed, pick it up, move it, weed, put it back down.
Cool.
This is the first time I've done this. And I will always do this from now on.
You like it?
Yeah, this one's kind of an odd shape.
It's not going to blow away. It's looks pretty good.
It doesn't blow away now. Yeah, that's the other thing is, you know, big hoop houses, I used to make big hoop houses, and they would last until the next windstorm. Then you had to rebuild them, buy new plastic and rebuild them. You know, it was just ridiculous. And so now, you know, it's a little better now with the windbreak.
Yeah.
But the before we go on to these other two good plants, my other disappointment over here, it used to be in 1817, McConkie here, and it just really did not.
So wait, those anything. Two there are.
These are my 409.
Oh, so these are some backups.
Some backups. And this one is also wigged out. This is where I grew the 849 last year. And no, this side is just...
I can see how the dirt's pretty sweet right through here.
Yeah, I mean, well, it's hard to tell. My dirt is not as bad as it looks. It's all just a mess. Because of all the rain, we haven't had time to do much.
Oh, it looks good to me.
But so it was an 1817 here, and it was even weaker than these two backups that are now in the site.
Looks like you got volunteers or what?
Yeah, some volunteers popping up all
over. Isn't that weird? You got pumpkins volunteering all over the pumpkin patch.
How many ones do you want to go? Okay, this is the 900 estimated Miller.
Oh yeah, this is the red, right?
Yeah, it's coming along. I really like this plant. It's well behaved. It's just, again, getting there. Got some weeding to do. Oh. Now you're probably wondering what this is on the ground.
I was going to ask that, yeah. Sawdust?
Sawdust. So, you know, over there, you can't really tell, but last year, my neighbor who makes violins as a hobby, he brought a bunch of sawdust and kept putting it over there. And when we started the year, that soil was just so sweet, so light, so fluffy. And that's where I've got my start, is those two plants over there. I mean,
right.
Those are the ones that are growing.
Yeah.
And so I've got another friend who does wood floors. And so between these two friends, I'm going to get as much sawdust as I can.
Yeah.
You know, it's
hardwoods.
I've tried manure, but it adds a lot of salt to my soil. And this sawdust, you know, it's... Probably should be broken down more, but I'll work it in. You know, I've already started kind of come out here and you turn the whole thing over. knock it down a little bit. We'll see.
I mean,
you know, you say, well, it'll tie up your nitrogen. Well, we add nitrogen. You know, we're not like a farmer who has 10,000 acres. They can't just go put nitrogen on everything, but we can. So I'm not worried about nitrogen tie-up necessarily. I just want to improve the soil, whether it's this year or next.
Oh, all the plants are looking good. I think we've just had this cold spring. As soon as this heat comes, they're going to run like mad.
Yeah. And finally, the one you haven't looked at is this Y75 Wolf, another orange seed. So really five plants that are going to amount to anything this year. The only one that's not really an orange seed is that 1873 Steel. Mm-hmm. The smallest ones. You know, this is the orange zone up here.
Yeah. So you're ahead of where you have been with those plants down there.
By far. I mean, normally this time of year, I'm looking like these two plants. I'm not looking like those two beauties over there. So.
And you're tying it all back to sawdust.
Well.
Or what is it?
To some degree. That area has had a lot of things put on it over the last several years, and it was an early start. Normally, I don't start as early as I did this year. By the first week of April, I was out there on those two, and that's also made the difference because that good hoop house I had has.
And how about your feeding and watering? I see you have some of these oscillators out here, some whizzers.
Yeah, I can water the whole garden pretty much I hope that one doesn't come on anytime soon.
Here. We could get ran out of here.
I can, you know, it's all on a timer, so I get basic watering just automatic.
Nice.
Then I can come out and do some specific watering at the times when I need it.
So during the regular summer hours, what are your watering schedules like?
These will come on at least once a day. Last year I did them in the heat of the day, especially with this guy, to water this whole side of the patch, and that made a big difference. That's one area I want to improve on this year as well. I want to get some water directly under the leaf surface of the plants,
mm-hmm.
which is something I haven't done before. Growers in our area have said, hey, my weights didn't really pick up until I directly applied water on a regular basis underneath the leaves. Because I'm usually an overhead waterer. And at the same time, I'm actually cooling the plant way down if I'm turning on that water. As you can feel it, you can feel it right now, you know, we're almost needing a jacket here on June 5th. turn on the overhead water and these plants are getting hit with 50 degree water or colder.
Yeah.
Just knocking them back. And so, once we get into real summer, I'd like to come out here with some ideas on either whether it's the drip tape or whether it's just some PVC with some holes drilled in it to just apply a bunch of water directly underneath the leaf surface, let it go slowly. And try not to cool off the plant so much.
So feeding, how do you feed out here?
Well, I mostly just use fish and seaweed.
But how do you apply it?
Foliar. Let it drip down to the root zone. When the plant's really cooking and big and going strong, then you just dump that stuff out onto it. But maybe about once a week is I'll do that, but I don't do a whole lot else. One of my biggest challenges, the soil does tend to get caked up. And you can tell I don't do a whole lot with walking discipline, at least at this stage of the game. Because I'll come out and I'll try to break it up with this pitchfork. Until we get to the point that it's a big plant and now you're approaching everything differently and walking carefully around outside. So
Well, one of the big advantages I see is you got a lot of space here. That's nice.
An advantage and a, you know, disadvantage. I can't just dedicate 100% to giant pumpkin plants.
You'd go
I've
crazy.
Got to weed the peas, man. You know, I've got to weed the garlic over there, and the, you know, the potatoes. Of course, we grow giant potatoes too.
Oh, really?
We're in Idaho. Well, yeah. I mean, they're normal potatoes. But
bring
get,
one of those down.
Big, so.
I want to see those. I'll bring the oil and the fryer.
Yeah, we should do that.
That's great.
So yeah, I got to do a few more things than just the giant pumpkins. Got to keep the great big lawn mowed and all that jazz. So.
Well, you got a beautiful place. How long have you been here?
We've been out here about 16 years. 17.
I'm 16. That's how you know.
Oh, okay.
I was just gonna ask that question.
Yeah. Oh, about 16 and a half. Then.
Yeah, 16 and a half years.
And we lived in Pocatello for 25, originally from Utah. So,
Northern Utah, where?
I'm in Utah, giant pumpkin grower. Well, I was born in Salt Lake. We lived in Seattle when I was growing up. Moved to Logan, Providence, actually, when I was a senior in high school.
Okay.
Which is kind of a shock to the system to move to a different state when you're a senior in high school. But it was fun. It was good. So I consider myself a Utahan, even though I've lived in Idaho majority of my life.
Yeah. So. Well, thanks so much for letting me sneak in and check it out. You've got a great thing going here. I expect big things. I expect a PB out of here. That's looking great.
That's
those two plants down there.
You know, I don't normally, you know, I don't say, oh, I want to win the way off, you know. Yeah. I'm more like, you know, I like to enjoy the journey. I want to have something to take it away off, don't get me wrong. And I'd like to have a personal best.
Yeah.
But beyond that, I'm, you know, maybe someday when I'm retired, we'll put all the resources into it or something. But I just like to enjoy the journey. I love being out here when everything's growing and green.
Mm-hmm.
That's the best time. It's just when things are beautiful out here. I just love being out here.
It's a therapy.
You know, I'll come out here at 11 o'clock at night, hopefully there's some moonlight, and just walk through the patch at 11 o'clock at night. You know,
that's where you find them?
And people think I'm crazy. Of course, there's not too many people to look at me here.
No, I saw your post, maybe it was last night, of the planes flying by in the night.
There's a plane, and it's not very loud because they're little planes, but they come in. There's one that comes in at 10:35, Pocatello. I've been on it myself a number of times, quite a few times. But, so, you know, I'll be able to mark the time by planes coming in.
Yeah, that's great.
Kind of fun.
Cool. Well, I'm going to get back on the road. Thanks so much for having me out.
Thanks for coming out.
Barging in, getting you out of work.
Yeah. Just told my boss I had to take an early lunch.